Section 1 of Harmonium. Time the bucks went clattering over Oklahoma, the firecat bristled in the way. Wherever they went clattering until they swerved in a swift circular line to the right, because of the firecat. Or until they swerved in a swift circular line to the left, because of the firecat. The bucks clattered, the firecat went leaping to the right, to the left, and bristled in the way. Later, the firecat closed his bright eyes and slept. Invective against swans. The soul, O ganders, flies beyond the parks and far beyond the discords of the wind. The bronze rain from the sun descending marks the death of summer, which that time endures like one who scrawls a listless testament of golden quirks and Paphian characters. Bequeathing your white feathers to the moon, giving your bland motions to the air, behold, already on the long parades, the crows anoint the statues with their dirt. And the soul, O ganders, being lonely, flies beyond your chilly chariots to the skies. In the Carolinas. The lilacs wither in the Carolinas. Already the butterflies flutter above the cabins. Already the newborn children interpret love in the voices of mothers. Timeless mother, how is it that your aspic nipples for once vent honey? The pine tree sweetens my body. The white iris beautifies me. The paltry nude starts on a spring voyage. But not on a shell, she starts archaic for the sea. But on the first found weed, she scuds the glitters, noiselessly like one more wave. She too is discontent, and would have purple stuff upon her arms, tired of the salty harbors, eager for the brine and bellowing of the high interiors of the sea. The wind speeds her, blowing upon her hands and watery back. She touches the clouds where she goes in the circle of her traverse of the sea. Yet this is meager play in the scurry and watershine, as her heels foam, not as when the goldener nude of a later day will go, like the center of sea-green pomp, in an intenser calm, scullion of fate, across the spick turret, ceaselessly, upon her irretrievable way. The Plot Against the Giant. First Girl. When this yokel comes maraudering, wetting his hacker, I shall run before him, diffusing the civilest odors out of geraniums and unsmelled flowers. It will check him. Second Girl. I shall run before him. Arching cloths, besprinkled with colors as small as fish eggs, the threads will abash him. Third Girl. Oh la, la pauvre. I shall run before him with a curious puffing. He will bend his ear then. I shall whisper. Heavenly labials in a world of gutturals will undo him. End of section 1.
Section 2 of Harmonium by Wallace Stevens. Infanta Marina. Her terrace was the sand, and the palms, and the twilight. She made of the motions of her wrist the grandiose gestures of her thought. The rumpling of the plumes of this creature of the evening came to be slights of sails over the sea. And thus she roamed in the roamings of her fan, partaking of the sea and of the evening, as they flowed around and uttered their subsiding sound. Domination of Black. At night, by the fire, the colors of the bushes and of the fallen leaves, repeating themselves, turned in the room, like the leaves themselves turning in the wind. Yes, but the color of the heavy hemlocks came striding, and I remembered the cry of the peacocks. The colors of their tails were like the leaves themselves turning in the wind. In the twilight wind, they swept over the room, just as they flew from the boughs of the hemlocks down to the ground. I heard them cry, the peacocks. Was it a cry against the twilight, or against the leaves themselves turning in the wind, turning as the flames turned in the fire, turning as the tails of the peacocks turned in the loud fire, loud as the hemlocks, full of the cry of the peacocks? Or was it a cry against the hemlocks? Out of the window, I saw how the planets gathered like the leaves themselves turning in the wind. I saw how the night came striding like the color of the heavy hemlocks. I felt afraid, and I remembered the cry of the peacocks. The Snowman. One must have a mind of winter to regard the frost in the boughs of the pine trees crusted with snow, and have been cold a long time to behold the juniper shagged with ice, the spruces rough in the distant glitter of the January sun, and not to think of any misery in the sound of the wind, in the sound of a few leaves, which is the sound of the land full of the same wind that is blowing in the same bare place for the listener who listens in the snow, and nothing himself beholds nothing that is not there, and the nothing that is. The Ordinary Women. Then from their poverty they rose, from dry catarrhs and two guitars they flitted through the palace walls. They flung monotony behind, turned from their want and nonchalant, they crowded the nocturnal halls. The lacquered loges huddled there, mumbled zay-zay and azay-azay. The moonlight fubbed the gerundals. In the cold dresses that they wore, and the vapid haze of the window bays, were tranquil as they leaned and looked from the window sills at the alphabets, at beta B and gamma G, to study the canting curlicues of heaven and of the heavenly script. And there they read of marriage bed, teal lilo, and they read right long. The gaunt guitarist on the strings rumbled a day and a day a day. The moonlight rose on the beachy floors. How explicit the coiffures became, the diamond point, the sapphire point, the sequins of the civil fans. Insinuations of desire, puissant speech alike in each, cried quittance to the wickless halls. Then from their poverty they rose, from dry guitars and two catarrhs they flitted through the palace walls. The Load of Sugar Cane. The going of the glade boat is like water flowing, like water flowing through the green saw grass under the rainbows, under the rainbows that are like birds turning bedizened, while the wind still whistles as killdeer do when they rise at the red turban of the boatman. End of section 2.
Section 3 of Harmonium by Wallace Stevens. Le Monocle de Mon Oncle. Mother of Heaven, Regina of the Clouds, O Scepter of the Sun, Crown of the Moon, there is not nothing, no, no, never nothing, like the clashed edges of two words that kill. And so I mocked her in magnificent measure, Or was it that I mocked myself alone? I wish that I might be a thinking stone. The sea of spuming thought foists up again the radiant bubble that she was, and then a deep uppouring from some saltier well within me bursts its watery syllable. A red bird flies across the golden floor. It is a red bird that seeks out his choir among the choirs of wind and wet and wing. A torrent will fall from him when he finds, shall I uncrumple this much crumpled thing? I am a man of fortune greeting airs, for it has come that thus I greet the spring. These choirs of welcome choir for me, farewell. No spring can follow past meridian. Yet you persist with anecdotal bliss to make believe a starry connaissance. Is it for nothing, then, that old Chinese sat titivating by their mountain pools, or in the Yangtze studied out their beards? I shall not play the flat historic scale. You know how Utamaro's beauties sought the end of love in their all-speaking braids. You know the mountainous coiffures of Bath. Alas, have all the barbers lived in vain that not one curl in nature has survived?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.